Hello and welcome to Unacademy's Let's Crack UPSC CSC in English channel. I am Rajshekhar Reddy, Faculty for Current Affairs, and today I would like to continue the series of lectures on top 200 topics in Current Affairs for Civil Services Examination 2020. To tell something about myself, I am a Faculty for Current Affairs and I have cleared the Civil Services Examination in 2014. I am a graduate in Computers from JNTU Hyderabad, and I have 7 years of experience teaching Current Affairs. You need to download the Unacademy Learning app to have access to the best of civil services coaching. You get a number of advantages by downloading the Unacademy Learning app. So you have live classes on a daily basis wherein you can chat with your educator, engage in discussions, ask doubts and answer polls all while the class is going on. So you can chat with the educator, engage in discussions with the educator, ask your doubts during the class and answer polls all while the class is going on. The courses on the learning app are structured, which comprehensively deal with the civil services syllabus. The exams are also conducted on a regular basis and you have unlimited access to the content on the Unacademy platform while you take the subscription. India's best educators are teaching on the Unacademy platform. So you have access to the best coaching in the country. A number of courses are available. So there are some 32 courses on polity, 30 courses on history and current affairs. So you can see and have access to all these courses by downloading the Unacademy Learning app and subscribing to it. You have a number of subscription options available. So you can subscribe for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months and 24 months. The best option is the 24-month subscription because it gives you a 67% discount. You can use my code RRUPSC. When you use this code, the transaction cost will come down to 57,600. So the final price will be 57,600 for 2 years, and you can convert this transaction into no-cost EMI. And the no-cost EMI can be extended up to 24 months. So this is the beauty of subscribing and learning on the Unacademy learning platform. So let us continue with the series on top 200 topics. So in this lecture, we will be dealing with four topics. So first is the Press Freedom Day along with the Press Freedom Index. So these two are very important for your exam. And you have a prize which is announced by UNESCO, that is Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize, which will be discussed in today's lecture. There are two important topics which are important for both the prelims as well as the mains examination, that is anti-defection law and the International Criminal Code. So these are the five issues that will be discussed in today's class. So let us start with the first topic for today's class. The first topic is World Press Freedom Day. So this topic falls under international days and themes. So there is a chance of a question in the civil services prelims examination. There can be one question on international days and themes. So you need to prepare the list of important international days and the themes of the international days. So the theme keeps changing every year, but the international day remains the same. So it will be observed on the same day usually for every year. So here we will be discussing about the World Press Freedom Day. So when is the World Press Freedom Day celebrated? What is the significance of this day? And what is the theme for the 2020 World Press Freedom Day? So the World Press Freedom Day is celebrated on May 3rd every year. So this is the anniversary of the Declaration of Windhoek. So May 3rd is celebrated as the World Press Freedom Day because it is the anniversary of the Declaration of Windhoek. So what is this Declaration of Windhoek? So Windhoek Declaration is a statement of press freedom principles adopted by African newspaper journalists in 1991. So the African newspaper journalists have adopted a set of principles on press freedom in 1991 on May 3rd. And this came to be known as the Declaration of Windhoek. And this day is celebrated as the World Press Freedom Day all over the world. So the theme for this year's World Press Freedom Day is journalism without fear or favor. So this is very important. Journalism without fear or favor is the theme for the International Press Freedom Day. The Press Freedom Day acts as a reminder to the governments of the need to respect their commitment to press freedom. So you might have come across a number of stories wherein journalists are killed for reporting the truth. So there is a need to uphold the freedom of the press, and this day acts as a reminder to the governments of the need to respect their commitment to press freedom. It is also a day of reflection among media professionals about the issues of press freedom and professional ethics. It also acts as a day to highlight the issues that affect the media today, that is freedom of the press as well as professional ethics. So it is an opportunity to celebrate the fundamental principles of press freedom, assess the state of press freedom throughout the world, defend the media from attacks on their independence, and pay tribute to those journalists who have lost their lives in the line of duty. So this is an important event celebrated all over the world, and it acts as a reminder to the governments to respect the freedom of the press as well as to the journalists to highlight the issues of press freedom and professional ethics. So international days and themes are commonly asked in competitive examinations, including the civil service examination. So May 3rd is the World Press Freedom Day, and the theme for this year's World Press Freedom Day is Journalism Without Fear or Favor. On the eve of the World Press Freedom Day, there is an index that is released. Sorry. This is called the World Press Freedom Index. So this is very, very important for your exam. So indexes in general are commonly asked in the civil service examination. So there are around 40 to 50 indexes that you come across in a year. All of them are important for the prelims examination especially. So when you study an index, you need to follow a particular pattern. So you must know what is a particular index, who publishes that particular index, what are the parameters involved in publishing that particular index, what is India's rank in that index, the best ranking country in the index, and if there are other any related issues, you need to highlight them. So this is the pattern which you need to follow for every index. So indexes, publishing organization, parameters, India's rank, best ranking country, and other related issues. Anything among this will be asked in the question paper. So let us apply this format to the World Press Freedom Index. So the World Press Freedom Index is published annually. So this is an index that is released annually, and it is released by an organization called Reporters Without Borders. So published every year since 2002 by Reporters Without Borders, the index ranks 180 countries and regions according to the level of freedom available to journalists. So this is an index which ranks countries according to the level of freedom available to journalists. So what is the level of freedom that is enjoyed by the journalists is basically ranked in this particular index. It is released by an organization called Reporters Without Borders. This is very important. You need to remember this organization. Reporters Without Borders is the organization, and it was launched in 2002, and it is released annually. The degree of freedom available to journalists in 180 countries is determined by pooling the responses of experts to a questionnaire devised by Reporters Without Borders. So how is this particular index formulated? So there is a questionnaire which is prepared by Reporters Without Borders, and this questionnaire is given to experts in every country, and they need to answer these questions. And this qualitative analysis is combined with quantitative data on abuses and acts of violence against journalists during the period evaluated. So there is a qualitative parameters as well as quantitative parameters. Quantitative parameters are basically data on abuses and acts of violence against journalists. So the data is available in every country as to the number of acts of abuses and acts of violence against journalists. As far as qualitative data is concerned, this is in the form of responses of experts to a questionnaire devised by the Reporters Without Borders. So there is a questionnaire which is given, and they need to answer this questionnaire. On the basis of both the qualitative parameters and quantitative parameters, this index is formulated. So what are the questionnaire that is given? So the criteria evaluated in the questionnaire basically revolves around 7 issues. So this questionnaire basically revolves around 7 issues. So what are those issues? Pluralism, media independence, media environment and self-censorship, legislative framework, transparency, the quality of infrastructure that supports the production of news and information. So these are the parameters. So pluralism, media independence, media environment and self-censorship, legislative framework, transparency, and the quality of infrastructure that supports the production of news and information. So the questionnaire is based on these seven issues, and they need to be answered by experts in a country. So both these qualitative and quantitative parameters will be clubbed, and an index will be formulated. So which country ranks first in this index? So the country that ranks first in this index is Norway. So Norway leads the index for 4 years in a row. The worst ranking country is North Korea. So Norway is the best ranking country. North Korea is the worst ranking country. What is India's rank? This is very, very important. So India's rank is 142 in the latest edition of the Press Freedom Index. So India is ranked 142 out of 180 in the latest World Press Freedom Index. India has actually lost two places. Last year we were ranked 140. Now we are ranked 142. What is the reason behind the decline in India's ranking? So according to Reporters Without Borders, India's position in this year's index is heavily affected by the situation in Kashmir. So because of the prevailing situation in Kashmir, because of the restrictions imposed on journalists to cover the Kashmir issue, the rank of our country has decreased by two positions. So the Reporters Without Borders went on to say that there has been a constant press freedom violations, including police violence against journalists, ambushes by political activists, and reprisals instigated by criminal groups or corrupt local officials. So they have criticized our country's policies in various ways. So they say that press freedom violations take place regularly, including police violence, ambushes by political activists, and reprisals instigated by criminal groups or corrupt local officials. This is what has been observed by Reporters Without Borders. So we have already designed the framework here. So this index is published on the World Press Freedom Day, which happens to be observed on May 3rd. The publishing organization is Reporters Without Borders. Parameters, so there are no specific parameters. It is basically a combination of qualitative and quantitative data which is taken into consideration while releasing the Press Freedom Index. India's rank is 142 in this index. The best ranking country is Norway. The worst ranking country is North Korea. So this is about the Press Freedom Index. So let us move on to the next topic. Next topic is an award that is presented by UNESCO. So what is that award and what are the various aspects related to this award? So the next topic is UNESCO Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize. So this is also something related to press freedom. So this is very important. Many people don't know about this. So there is an award instituted by UNESCO and is awarded annually to journalists. This award is called Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize. So you need to remember this award, Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize. So this topic falls under a specific category of questions. So this includes awards, categories, and winners. So in the last series, we talked about the film awards. So we spoke about the Dada Saheb Phalke Award, National Awards, and Oscar Awards. So similarly, this is also an award, and it is given in the category of the Press Freedom. And you must also know the recipient of the latest Press Freedom Prize. So this is an award which was created in 1997. So created in 1997, the annual UNESCO Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize honors a person, organization, or institution that has made outstanding contribution to the defense and or promotion of press freedom anywhere in the world, and especially when this has been achieved in the face of danger. So this is an award created in 1997 by UNESCO. It honors an individual, organization, or institution that has made an outstanding contribution to the defense. So it honors a person, organization, or institution that has made outstanding contribution to the defense and for the promotion of press freedom anywhere in the world, especially when there is danger. So when this has been achieved in the face of danger. So the prize was established on the initiative of UNESCO's executive board. So who gives this award is, the answer is UNESCO. And it is awarded or announced on May 3rd every year. So it is conferred on May 3rd. So it is named after this person, Guillermo Cano Isaza. So Guillermo Cano Isaza is the name of the person in whose honor this award has been instituted by UNESCO. He was a Colombian journalist who was killed in front of his office in 1986. This person was a famous Colombian journalist who was killed or assassinated in front of his own office in 1986. So who is the latest recipient? This is very important. So this award for the year 2020 was given to Jeanette Bedoya Lima. So she was given this award, Jeanette Bedoya Lima. She, I think, is a Colombian investigative journalist. So Colombian investigative journalist Jeanette Bedoya Lima has been named as the laureate of the 2020 UNESCO Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize on the recommendation of an independent international jury of media professionals. So this is also a very simple topic. You need to know a couple of points. So Guillermo Cano World Press Freedom Prize is given in the field of press freedom. It is given by UNESCO. It is named after a Colombian journalist, Guillermo Cano. This year, it has been awarded to a Colombian investigative journalist, Jeanette Bedoya Lima. So you need to remember this name, Jeanette Bedoya Lima. It can be asked in the prelims examination. So let us move on to the next topic for today's class. So this is the anti-defection law. So what is the anti-defection law? Why is this in the news? What are the various issues that surround the anti-defection law? Anti-defection law is always in the news. So every year this will be in the news. So in India, this has become one of the most controversial laws enacted till date. So recently, this has been in the news because of the developments that have taken place in the state of Rajasthan. So what are the developments that have taken place in the state of Rajasthan? What happened following those developments? And why should we bring the anti-defection law into the picture? So as you all know, Congress party is in power in Rajasthan, but there is a political crisis which was created because of Sachin Pilot and his supporters. So the Congress party has decided to disqualify Sachin Pilot and 18 other MLAs who have supported him. So the Congress party's move to disqualify former Deputy Chief Minister Sachin Pilot and 18 other dissident MLAs under the anti-defection provisions laid down in the Constitution was challenged by Sachin Pilot before the Rajasthan High Court. So Sachin Pilot challenged the question of disqualification of his MLAs as well as himself before the Rajasthan High Court. So what is this anti-defection law? And under this law, they have been issued notices by the Speaker of the Rajasthan Assembly. First of all, you need to know go back to 2018. So in 2018, elections were held to the Rajasthan Legislative Assembly. Congress won the elections. Congress got 107 seats out of 200 in the elections. So Congress got a clear majority in the elections. What happens is if Sachin Pilot has been disqualified, so if 19 members who support Sachin Pilot or 18 members who support Sachin Pilot disqualified, then the strength of the House will be reduced to 181. So if these people are disqualified, then the strength reduces to 181. If these people are not disqualified, then the strength remains 200. So what happens is if the strength is reduced by to 181, the majority that is required to form the government is just 91. So only 91 members are required to form the government. Ashok Gehlot, who is the Chief Minister of Rajasthan, has the support of 88 Congress MLAs. So there are 88 MLAs left in the Congress. So he just needs the support of three persons if Sachin Pilot and his MLS are disqualified. So I'll be repeating this once again. So in 2018, elections were held to the Rajasthan Assembly. Rajasthan Assembly has 200 members. So in the elections, the Congress party got 107 seats. The BJP emerged as the second largest party with 72 seats. So the Congress formed the government. The Chief Minister was or the Chief Minister of Rajasthan is Ashok Gehlot. Sachin Pilot was made the Deputy Chief Minister, but owing to differences between Ashok Gehlot and Sachin Pilot, Sachin Pilot, along with his group of MLAs have decided to raise the banner of revolt against Ashok Gehlot. And this action on the part of Sachin Pilot was not accepted by the Congress High Command, and they have invoked the anti-defection law. In such a situation, there are two scenarios. If the disqualification of these MLAs is accepted, so if the Speaker disqualifies these MLAs, then the strength of the House will be reduced to 181. If the strength of the House is reduced to 181, Ashok Gehlot requires the support of just three independent MLAs to form the government or to continue as the Chief Minister. But if the MLAs and Sachin Pilot are not disqualified, then the government of Ashok Gehlot will be in trouble, because these people will definitely vote against Ashok Gehlot, and the chances are that the Ashok Gehlot government may fall. So the ball is now in the court of the Speaker. Before the Speaker decides on the question of defection, the Sachin Pilot group has approached the Rajasthan High Court and have asked for a stay on the disqualification proceedings by the Speaker. So, as I have told you, if the Pilot group is disqualified, the effective strength will be 181 and the halfway mark is 91. This means the Gehlot needs the backing of just three independents, which is a comfortable position for him to form the government. So, what is the matter now is before the Rajasthan High Court. Now, we will have to see the anti-defection law. So, what happens to these MLAs and Sachin Pilot? So, what are the provisions that are available in the anti-defection law with respect to the issue of defection? So, first of all, this is the distribution of MLAs. As I have already told you, the strength is 200. The Indian National Congress has 107. There are other parties like the Bharatiya Tribal Party, Communist Party of India, Marxist, so which have two members. RLD has one member. Independents, 12 independents support Ashok Gehlot. The BJP, however, has 72 members. So RLP has supported BJP, so they have 3 members. And there is one more independent who supports the Bharatiya Janata Party. So let us now look into the anti-defection law. So what is the anti-defection law, and what are the issues that arise out of the anti-defection law? There is a famous saying or a catchphrase which is very popular when it comes to defections. It is Ayaram Gayaram. So the famous Ayaram Gayaram catchphrase became a new normal in Indian politics after Gayalal, an MLA from Haryana, changed his party thrice within a day in the year 1967. So in this year 1967, an MLA belonging to the Congress party has changed his party thrice during the same day. So within one day, they have he has changed the party thrice. So this since 1967, this issue of defections or unethical defections has become very common in Indian politics. Governments have been formed as well as collapsed because of this unethical defections. So the origin can be traced to the act of Mr. Gayalal in 1967. To prevent this sort of mischief, the Rajiv Gandhi government passed the 52nd Constitutional Amendment Act in 1985 to amend 4 articles and add the 10th schedule to the Constitution. So this is very, very important. So to prevent this sort of unethical defections, the Rajiv Gandhi government passed the 52nd Constitutional Amendment Act in 1985. So the anti-defection law was added to the Constitution by the 52nd Constitutional Amendment Act. The 52nd Constitutional Amendment Act added the 10th schedule to the Constitution of India. The 10th schedule has the anti-defection law, and the 52nd Constitutional Amendment Act has also amended some 4 articles of the Constitution of India. So what does the anti-defection law say? So what does it say when it comes to political defections? So the anti-defection law provides for the disqualification of members of parliament as well as state legislatures if they defect from one political party to another. So if a person who gets elected to the assembly or the parliament from one political party defects to a different political party, to another political party, then he is subject to disqualification. and this is specified in the anti-defection law. So the act contained in the 10th schedule of the constitution provides for disqualification of members of parliament as well as the state legislature if they defect from one political party to another. What constitutes a defection? So how do you say whether a person has defected from one party to another party? So a person is disqualified as a member of the house belonging to a political party when he or she voluntarily gives up membership of his or her original party. So a person is disqualified as a member of the house belonging to a political party if he voluntarily gives up membership of his or her original political party. So if a person resigns from his political party, it amounts to disqualification because he has given up membership of his political party. So he will be subject to disqualification. Or if the member votes or abstains from voting in such house contrary to directions issued by his or her political party without obtaining permission from the party, and such an act of the member is not forgiven by the party within 15 days. This is very, very important. If a member of the house votes against the wishes of his political party, and if that vote is not condoned or if that vote is not forgiven within 15 days, then he is subject to disqualification. So there are two conditions under which a member can be disqualified. First, if he resigns from his political party, then he is subject to disqualification. Or if he votes or abstains from voting against the wishes of his political party, then, and if his act is not forgiven within 15 days, then he is also subject to disqualification under the anti-defection law. There are certain other provisions available in the anti-defection law. These include independent members. These basically pertain to independent members. So independent members are not allowed to join any political party. If they join any political party after they get elected to the house, then they are subject to disqualification as a member of the house. So independent members must continue to remain as independent members. They cannot join any political party. Further, nominated members can join any political party within 6 months after getting nominated to the house. The assembly has a provision for one nominated member belonging to the Anglo-Indian community. Lok Sabha has a provision for two nominated members from the Anglo-Indian community. Recently, an amendment was introduced in the parliament to remove this provision. The Rajya Sabha has 12 nominated members. So these nominated members can join any political party, but they have to join within 6 months after getting nominated to the house. Else, they will be disqualified if they join any political party. So, if a person, if a member of a party voluntarily gives up his membership, then he will be subject to disqualification. If he votes or abstains from voting against the wishes of his political party, then also he is subject to disqualification. Then if independent members join any political party, then they will be subject to disqualification. And most importantly, nominated members cannot join a political party after 6 months. So, they can join a political party within 6 months, but they cannot after 6 months. Are there any exceptions under the law? Yes, there are certain exceptions. The law allows for splits and mergers. So if 2/3 of the members of a political party split from a political party and join a different party, then they will not be subject to disqualification. Assume that there are 9 members belonging to a political party in the house, and if 6 members decide to split and join a different political party, they will not be subject to disqualification. The remaining 3 members also will not be subject to disqualification. Legislators may change their party without the risk of disqualification in certain circumstances. The law allows a party to merge with or into another party provided that at least 2/3 of its legislators are in favor of the merger. So if 2/3 of the members of a political party split from the party and merge into a different political party, then they will not be disqualified. The remaining members will also be not disqualified. And there is one more exception to the law. If the speaker resigns from his political party after getting elected as the speaker, and if he rejoins the same political party, then he will not be disqualified. So the presiding officer can resign from his political party in order to work impartially and independently, and he will not be subject to disqualification. So there are only 2 exceptions to the anti-defection law. So how has this anti-defection law worked? So this is very clear. So there is no confusion as far as anti-defection law is concerned. The law is very, very clear. But who will decide on the question of disqualification? So the question of disqualification will be decided by the Speaker of the House. So the presiding officer, if it is the Lok Sabha, it will be the Speaker. And if it is the Rajya Sabha, it is the Vice President. So the presiding officer can act upon a defection only upon receiving a complaint from a member of the House. So there is a procedure. So there should be a complaint given against a member of the House by his party. This complaint must be given to the presiding officer, who either can be the Speaker or the Vice President. After receiving the complaint, the presiding officer grants time to the member. So the presiding officer asks the concerned member to reply to this notice, that is the disqualification notice. If the presiding officer does not receive any clarification or any response from the concerned member, he can decide the disqualification ex parte, that is without the presence or clarification from the concerned member. So the power to decide on the question of disqualification is with the Speaker of the House or with the Vice President if it is the Rajya Sabha. And they initially give time for the concerned legislator to respond to the petition of disqualification, and they will act accordingly after the response or even without the response. Who is the final authority to decide the question of disqualification? So this is something which is interesting. The law says that the Speaker is the final authority when it comes to the question of disqualification. The presiding officer is the person who is the ultimate authority as far as disqualification is concerned. However, the Supreme Court has said that the decision of the presiding officer is not final. So let me read what I have written here. So while the grounds of disqualification are clear, the question remains as to who will decide whether the disqualification is justified or not. So though the grounds of disqualification are clear, the question remains as to who will decide whether the disqualification is justified or not. So according to the anti-defection provisions in the 10th schedule, the question over whether the disqualification of a member of a house is warranted is referred to the presiding officer of the house, and his or her decision is final. So according to the anti-defection law, the decision of the presiding officer is final. However, the Supreme Court said, and in fact the law says, that no court shall have the jurisdiction in the matters connected with the disqualification of a member of the house under this schedule. So the act clearly says that the courts cannot interfere on the question of disqualification or on the decision taken by the Speaker of the House or the presiding officer of the House. However, the Supreme Court has given a judgment. So there is a very, very famous case. You need to remember this case. This case is called the Kihoto Holohan versus Zaichilhu. So in the Kihoto Holohan versus Zaichilhu, or if I am not wrong, forgive me for pronunciation. So however, in the Kihoto Holohan case, the Supreme Court held that the provision is unconstitutional. So the Supreme Court said that the decision of the presiding officer of the house is subject to judicial review. So this is something which the Supreme Court has said in the Kihoto Holohan case. The law says that the decision of the Speaker or the presiding officer is final, but the Supreme Court said that the decision of the Speaker is subject to judicial review. However, the Supreme Court has clarified that the court can interfere only after the decision is taken by the Speaker. So only after the Speaker takes the decision does the Supreme Court judge on the merits of the case. What are the limitations of the anti-defection law? So this is very, very important. The anti-defection law suffers from a number of limitations. First, the power to decide on the question of disqualification is given to the presiding officer of the house. The presiding officer or the Speaker of the house usually belongs to the ruling party, and he usually favors the ruling party. So he does not act in an independent manner. So we can see that the Speaker of the house usually acts according to directions given by the ruling party. So this itself makes the law very, very weak. So the question of disqualification will be decided by the Speaker, who acts according to the ruling party. So it is the ruling party which will decide whether to accept the a disqualification of an individual or not. So this is something unfortunate. We need to make a change in the law in order to ensure that the speaker is not the person who is responsible for deciding on the question of disqualification. There is also one more allegation against the anti-defection law that it violates the freedom of speech and expression that is available to the members of the parliament or the members of the legislature, state legislature. So the anti-defection law seeks to provide a stable government by ensuring the legislatures do not switch sides. So this was enacted to ensure that there is a stable government and the legislatures do not switch sides. So they don't jump from one political party to another political party. However, this law also restricts a legislator from voting in line with his conscience. So a legislator under this law cannot vote according to his conscience. This is something which is very unfortunate. So on the one hand, we have the issue of the stability of the governments. On the other hand, we have the important and sacred principle of freedom of speech and expression. The anti-defection law does not allow the legislator to vote according to his conscience, but he can vote only according to the directions issued by his party leadership. So whatever the party leadership says must be followed by this person. He cannot have an individual choice. He cannot act independently. Political parties issue a direction to MPs on how to vote on most issues, irrespective of the nature of the issue. So political parties issue directions to every MLA. They issue a whip to every MLA on how to vote, on how to act in a particular instance. So several experts have suggested that the law should be valid only for those votes that determine the stability of the government. So this, as I have told you, is something which is unfortunate because legislatures do not have the freedom to talk. So this act needs to be amended, and the voting of MLAs or MPs must be confined only if it is with respect to the stability of the government, which means that if it is with respect to no confidence motion or the budget. On all other issues, they must be given independence to vote according to their conscience. So this provision of voting must be restricted to the stability of the government. So the voting must be restricted to determine the stability of the government. On all other issues, they must be allowed to act independently. The law also does not specify a time period within which the presiding officer must act on a disqualification plea. So the presiding officer is not given any time limit within which he needs to respond. This is something which is unfortunate, and this has become a major drawback of the anti-defection law. The courts can interfere only after the presiding officer decides on the question of disqualification. However, there have been a number of instances where the speaker has allowed to keep the file with respect to disqualification for an indefinite period. So the law does not specify a time period for the presiding officer to decide on the disqualification plea. Given that courts can interfere only after the presiding officer has decided on the matter, the petitioner seeking disqualification has no option but to wait for the decision to be made. So the petitioner, that is the party which asks for the disqualification, has no other option but to wait till the decision is made by the speaker. There have been several cases where the courts have expressed concern about the unnecessary delay in deciding such petitions. So courts have also expressed concern regarding the unnecessary delay with respect to disposal of such disqualification petitions. In some cases, this delay in decision making has resulted in members who have defected from their parties continuing to be members of the house. So since the decision on the question of disqualification is not taken by the speaker within a specified period of time, the defectors continue to be members of the house. So there is a famous episode in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Members belonging to the YSRC have jumped to the Telugu Desam party. So this was the previous assembly. There were from 23 MLAs who jumped from YSRC to the Telugu Desam party, but no action was taken on these 23 MLAs. Some of them were even made ministers, which is unfortunate. So there have been instances where opposition members have been appointed as ministers. So this is with respect to the episode that has happened in Andhra Pradesh, while still retaining the membership of their original parties. So they retain the membership of their original parties, but they have been made as ministers by the ruling party. So there is also a question that arises with respect to splits and mergers. So this law allows the merger of a political party if it splits, I mean, if two-thirds of the members split from their political party and merge into a different political party, then they will not be subject to disqualification. But how do you count this two-third number? So usually defections take place over a long period of time. So initially two or three members come out of the party, they will be joined by two more members, they will be joined by two more members. Ultimately, this final number will be two-thirds of the strength of the political party. Finally, the presiding officer allows the decision or takes the decision to merge this entire group as a single split. In some scenarios, the MLAs who are subject to disqualification defected the ruling party in smaller groups. So as I've told you, all the two-thirds members do not come in a single instance. They come in small groups, and over a period of time, these small groups accumulate and become a two-third group. However, it is not clear if they still face the question of disqualification if the presiding officer makes a decision after two-thirds of the opposition has defected to the ruling party. So this is something interesting. So for example, in Telangana, this has happened. So the Telangana speaker in March 2016 allowed the merger of the Telugu Desam legislature party in Telangana with the ruling TRS, citing that in total 80% of the TDP MLAs have joined the TRS at the time of taking the decision. So in the last assembly of Telangana, what happened was the Telugu Desam party had 15 MLAs. These MLAs started jumping into the TRS, that is Telangana Rashtra Samiti. But all the 12 members did not go to the TRS at a single time. So initially three members have left, then two members, then a single member, then again two members, then two members. So all these people have gone to the TRS over a period of 1-2 years. And the speaker after 2 years takes a decision that since 12 members of the TDP have joined the TRS, I am allowing the merger of the TDP into the TRS, which is completely unfortunate because these defections have happened over a long period of time. They have not happened in a single instance. So the law must be amended to allow for a single instant merger. There should not be multiple mergers, and these multiple mergers cannot be added to form the two-thirds group. And this is a violation of the spirit of the anti-defection law. There are certain recommendations given. So the Supreme Court very recently has asked the Parliament to amend the Constitution to strip the speaker or the legislative assembly speakers of their exclusive power to decide whether legislators should be disqualified or not under the anti-defection law. So the Supreme Court asked the Parliament to make a law, and this law must strip the speaker of the power to decide on the question of disqualification. So there should be another body which should decide on the question of disqualification, which is a very, very important recommendation. So the Supreme Court said an independent tribunal ought to be appointed instead to determine the fate of an MP or an MLA who has switched sides for money or power. So the question of disqualification must be decided by an independent tribunal. That is what the Supreme Court has said in a very recent judgment. There should also be a time limit within which the speaker has to make a decision. So there should be a time limit within which the speaker has to make a decision. This is also something which is very, very important. So this is about the anti-defection law and the various issues that pertain to anti-defection law. So this is a very, very important issue. So this is in the news because of the defection of Sachin Pilot. So the revolt of Sachin Pilot. He has not defected to any political party, but the Congress party has filed a petition before the Speaker of the Rajasthan Assembly that he has voluntarily given membership of his original party. So Supreme Court has in a number of cases has said that a member need not officially resign, but his acts can be taken as ground for coming to the conclusion that he has resigned from his political party. So this is about the anti-defection law. So we will continue with the series. So in the next series, we will discuss about the International Criminal Court and various other topics. So thank you for listening. Have a good day. Please subscribe to my channel. You can follow me at on the Telegram channel. So call me at this number 767-3939-090. Please use my code RRUPSC. If you use this code, you get a 10% additional discount on your subscription fee. You can follow me on Telegram. So my Telegram ID is Rajasekhar Reddy K. So if you like the video, please like, comment and share this video with your friends who are civil services aspirants. So thank you for watching. Have a great day.